Welcome everyone to this week's broadcast of AASCENDTV, Life on the Autism Spectrum. I'm Keith Halperin.
And I'm Will Burnick.
Okay. And today our guests are Mary and David Nisson, who will be discussing what will happen when I'm gone. Mary and David have created a new group that they will be going into and discussing called the Developmental Disabilities Future Planning Group. But before we get into the discussion with our guests, Will, what's with your shirt this time?
I'm glad you asked. This week's shirt is my Chinese New Year shirt. This is today, as you know, February is Chinese New Year. And this year is the year of the tiger. And everyone knows, it's that time of the year. So this is the year of the tiger, and San Francisco has brought back their Chinese New Year traditions. I went to the Chinese New Year festival last Sunday, and I had a good time. They were on a 1 year hiatus because of COVID, but they came back, and it was just like it was before.
Excellent. And thank you. And thank you again, Will. Would you like to get into your first questions with our guests?
Tell us about how you became involved in the autism community.
Well, Will, I think David was too young, right, David?
Yeah.
So I'll take that answer because he probably was too young to remember our first involvement in the autism community because he was still just about a toddler. So it was the early 90s, about 1993. We were noticing, on the one hand, David had something called hyperlexia, which means very early to learn how to learn the alphabet and how to read. And hypercalculia, which is the opposite of dyscalculia, which means very early to learn about numbers and math. And so by 4 years old, David was, so by about 1992, when he was four, he was already reading at the high school and some things at the college level, and pulled a chemistry book off the shelf that had belonged to his dad back in school and could already read the text and solve the problems. But this was combined with not hitting the milestones for neurotypical behavior milestones. So that's where his dad and I took David to the Alta California Regional Center first for his first assessment, followed up by UCSF. And then it was years later when David finished elementary school in about sixth grade, that Dr. Daryl Treffert, the leading authority on Savant syndrome autism, he's who diagnosed David then a little later as officially with Savant syndrome autism. So the involvement in the autism community came with that about age four, 1992 through 94, those years in there, the agencies diagnosing David. And during that time, I went to conferences and met up early in the game with, I believe, Adam Pollack, and then later Greg Yates were at a couple of conferences. And then, and so the birthplace of what Autastics originally. And then of course later we remained friends then with those guys. And so we've been involved for a long time with AASCEND and the autism community.
Tell us about how you obtained a PhD in physics and what you're doing now.
I went from high school through the community college and then transferred to UC Davis. And I got, I studied in undergrad. I went through a bachelor's program in particle physics, and then because I'd been really obsessed with the Higgs boson since I was a kid, since I was in high school, and then I did undergrad research, and then I went And then from there, I went on to graduate school on a need-based fellowship. And I stayed in physics and stayed at UC Davis through my whole of graduate school. And I went through UC Davis getting accommodations and the necessary accommodations for my disabilities and all the way through graduate school, including having a personal assistant for laboratory safety, and then because I was working in a laboratory, and during the oral exam, the way this college worked was the oral exam had they didn't do like traditional colleges do where you had to write your dissertation and then defend it. Instead, they had an oral exam after your preliminary written exam, after your first year, and then after the second year there was an oral exam, and then you got your master's degree, and I got mine in 2013, and I had to. What I did was I practiced and practiced, and that helped me overcome my speaking challenges and language challenges for the oral exam, and so I went all the way through and got my master's and PhD from UC Davis and in condensed matter physics.
Thank you very much, David and Mary. We'll now transition to our guest interviewer and Ascend co-founder and president, Camilla Bixer, for additional questions.
Okay, thanks, Keith. David, I'm very interested in your dissertation. Can you tell us the topic or the title of the dissertation?
Okay, so the title is Nuclear Magnetic Resonance Studies of Topological Insulators and Materials with a Large Spin Orbit Coupling. And this is research that will help that has potential applications in making more energy efficient electronic devices.
Wow. That's exceedingly impressive. Let's stop for a minute. I lost my train. Okay, so that's exceedingly impressive. And what led you to an interest in physics?
Well, I've been interested in science since I was a boy, 8 years old. I mean, as Mom said earlier, I started reading and calculations when I was a baby, and then by 8 years old, I physically knew I wanted to go into science. And then in high school, I started exploring the different sciences and decided physics is really what I wanted to study the most. And
wow.
I was also into computer programming though. And
okay, did you find that your teachers were supportive of you going through college and the graduate program?
For the most part, they were.
Mm-hmm. And what about challenges? Mary, maybe you could talk a little bit about some of the challenges.
Thank you, Camilla. Probably the greatest challenge had to do with laboratory safety. Academic laboratories, all science labs are very dangerous places. And we especially have specific challenges in the academic laboratory setting. So it's dangerous for everyone. And so somebody with David's, special challenge of sometimes hyper-focusing in so much on what he's working on that he could miss the alarm going off, warning the people that a deadly gas has escaped. In their particular lab, there was a very deadly gas that could sometimes escape from its doer and kill everyone within 5 minutes. So that was somebody who had to have constant protective supervision, someone dedicated to being there for David at the lab. So the big challenge was that it wasn't realistic for somebody else who was a PA paid by the regional center or one of the, we've got Community and Employment Services, a great little agency here, but it wasn't realistic scheduling wise to have them at David's side. So I needed to be that person. And so we worked it out, but that was the big challenge was serving as David's assistant for laboratory safety.
Mary, I want to ask you, how much physics did you learn in this process?
Actually enough that when David got his PhD, some of the people in grad studies, the grad studies department at UC Davis, they wanted to be able to have me get one of those honorary degrees, right? And because I'd learned so much at the bachelor's level, not enough as much as Dave knew specifically about this topological insulators, but I had learned a lot of physics. So they wanted me to have an honorary degree right as UC president.
Okay, so Mary and David, one thing that impresses me greatly is your positive attitude and your positive energy. How did you sustain that through all of these years, and how have you been able to sustain it?
Yeah, it was really my religious faith that helped that helped keep me going, keep both of us going through those years. And mom motivated to do to make the sacrifices, her personal sacrifices, quitting her teaching job and being a single mom, quitting her teaching job and having IHSS be your only source of income. It was, during all those years. And then, so to answer your question, it's been, it's pretty much been faith that's motivated me to do to persist through college and through these times.
Great answer, Mary. What about you? What would you add?
Yes, and likewise. It's a huge decision to make the loss projected income conscious decision of a loss projected income opportunity cost decision financially. So it happens to be part of my religion and my faith to believe that it's no accident when somebody has a skill like David's, and that there's a higher purpose and it's more important than worrying about money, and it's okay to live a less expensive life for the sake of making sure that person's dream comes true. If that person has a dream for whatever it is, science in this case, that whatever it takes to get that dream coming true, that it's for a higher purpose. And that happens to be my faith.
That's great. So David, what are you doing now that you have your PhD?
Well, what I'm doing now actually is I'm actually using the computer programming skills, which I gained in part during, which I gained a lot of during the course of studying physics. I'm using my other computers have always been my other obsession, and I'm using them to, and I'm a web developer for Progressive Employment Concepts. It's an employment agency that helps people in the Sacramento area and the Davis area find employment that fits their needs, and for disabled people. And it's and also UPTI, which is an organization that helps that provides free tutoring to low-income students in the New York area mostly, but expanding.
Tell us about your group for parents.
Well, Will, it's called the Developmental Disability Future Planning Group. And its abbreviation is DDFP or double DFP. It's a group that consists of parents who meet monthly regarding planning the future, housing, supports, big emphasis on housing and supports for their adult sons and daughters. Other people have teens or even children who are thinking ahead. And so that's our group. We have a Spanish language group that meets because I speak a little Spanish enough, basta bien, well enough to lead that group. And that group is called GPWD, GPWD, Grupo por Planificación de Discapacidad de Desarrollo. And so that's our group, but we'll just talk about DDFP, the English language group today.
Thank you very much, Mary and David. You have been wonderful guests, very inspiring and encouraging to our viewers. If there is anything additional that our viewers would like to find out from you, what is the best way to contact either or both of you? For our viewers out there who would like to find out more information and to possibly contact you and or David about your personal experiences or your organization, what is the best way of doing so?
They can visit our website at Developmental Disabilities Future Planning Group. And they can also email me at ddfp.planning@gmail.com.
Mary and David, thank you again for being our guest. You have been a delight and an inspiration, and I know we'll be hearing more good things from you as time goes on. Now, everyone, we'll be transitioning over to our cultural correspondent, Stacey Kennedy.
Hello. Today, I would like to share that Tuesday, March 8th, and it's the second Tuesday of every month. It turns out there's a network for autistic professionals on Zoom where people learn to network and share, and it's a free event. You're welcome to join and participate or just, you know, lurk in the corner, either way. All events will be recorded, of course, if you can't make it to the Zoom. So, but yeah, this is an event. Again, it's Network for Autistic Professionals, and they're always seeking neurodiverse and neurotypical presenters. So there is a phone number you can dial to find out more and about it. It's 408-735-7990. Sunday, March 27th, 1:30 p.m. to 7 p.m., Mountain View Center of Performing Arts is having an event called Nature Calling for Harmony. And I saw a little thing that said something about Descendants, the musical. This will be an autism sensory-friendly performance. Pre-tickets are now at great prices and no need for a code to find good seats. To find out more, go to www.pre-sale-tickets, or you can call 650-903-6000. So Mountain View Center of Performing Arts, Nature Calling for Harmony, March 27th. Last but not least, there's a group on Facebook called Autism Bloggers, and there's 568 members. And this is a note from Christopher Scott Watt. Only individual members, no companies, products, services, or charities for bloggers who are on the spectrum and family members who write about autism related issues. We encourage you to post links to the latest blog entries and consider adding members to the blog role and helping expand our reach. And this is not the place for debates about causes or cures. You may link two parts of those issues, but this community is meant to help bloggers and reach wider audiences. And so, yeah, so this is called Autism Bloggers, and Christopher Scott is the main founder. Other social media autism influencers are a part of it too. So thanks very much.
Thank you, Stacey. We'll now hear from our book correspondent, Jennifer Brooks.
Good evening. I am Jennifer Brooks, your book correspondent for Life on the Autism Spectrum. And today I would like to tell you about the book Mismatch by Kat Holmes. The subtitle is How Inclusion Shapes Design. And design is all around us, from the design of the phones in our pockets to the design of the clothes we're wearing, the cars we drive, and the cities or suburban or rural environments that we live in. They were all designed. They were all designed by someone, and the person who designed them for certain types of people, which unfortunately, because we are all different, some of the designs prevented many people from being able to use them. Kat Holmes gives many examples of this in her book, from designing cities that were explicitly designed to exclude certain racial minorities, to designing technology that requires two hands to use. And you might think, well, what's the problem with that? Everybody has two hands, don't they? Well, actually, there are some people who may have injured or even lost the use of their hands, either temporarily or permanently, due to an accident of some sort. And Matt, where are you going?
Don't worry about me. Just keep on going.
Okay. And that is one example of design that, whether that was the designer's purpose or not, it excludes certain people from being able to use the design. The book does not specifically mention autism, although Stanford, our ASEN friend, Dr. Lawrence Fung, teaches a course on autism-friendly design. And so toward the end of the book, she does make this point. Design is essential to inclusive growth. It closes the gaps in the interactions between people and the world around them. We need solutions for human environments that adapt to fit individual needs, diverse bodies, and diverse minds. There are many, 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 many different types of human diversity. There is no such thing as an average human. Another example is in the book is the story of during World War II, the military wanted to design fighter jets that they thought would fit the bodies and the needs of every soldier. So they took all kinds of measurements. They averaged them all and they built a cockpit, one-dimensional cockpit that was designed for the average of all the measurements they took. Well, it turned out that there weren't any soldiers that fit into that cockpit, and it was causing them to lose a lot of soldiers in plane crashes, which is obviously not a good situation. And so then they came up with the idea of adjustable cockpits, adjustable seats, adjustable whatever else they might have in an airplane cockpit. And that worked much better. And as soon as they implemented that design, crashes and the loss of soldiers decreased dramatically. So let that be a lesson. One size does not fit all, whether you're designing airplane cockpits or whether you're designing an education system. I noticed as early as first grade that there was a mismatch between what my school was teaching me and what I really needed to learn. It's just quite insightful for a first grader. I'm not sure how I knew that. Somehow I just knew. And she doesn't talk much about education in this book, but she does say that the top 10 job skills that employers say they're looking for are complex problem solving, critical thinking, creativity, people management, coordinating with others, emotional intelligence, judgment and decision-making, service orientation, negotiation, and cognitive flexibility. None of those subjects are taught in a typical school system, either K-12 or college. When have you ever taken a class devoted to any of those subjects? When have you ever had an opportunity? When have you ever seen a college catalog that offered a course devoted to one of those subjects? They just don't exist. Or if they do, they are so few and far between that I personally have never seen one. And so one point she does make is that when people are designing things, they often don't intend to be exclusionary. Obviously, the Army did not intend to design airplane cockpits that would cause their soldiers to crash their planes and lose their lives. That was not their intention. Now, sometimes it was the intention to design cities to exclude racial minorities. Other times, the people designing the video game controllers, they all had two hands and they were all perfectly healthy and had excellent manual dexterity. So they simply didn't think about people whose manual dexterity is compromised for one reason or another. But whether intentional or unintentional, exclusionary design does negatively impact a lot of people's lives. And so throughout the book, at the end of every chapter, she gives some short tips about how to shift toward inclusion. Here are the tips at the very end of the book. Use the cycle of exclusion to assess where you are today and where to start. Apply the principles of inclusive design to any element of the cycle of exclusion. Integrate inclusive design methods within your team to build a purposeful culture where people can do their best work. And another point is that we need to have diverse people on the teams that are designing, whether it's a technological device or a city landscape, and not have one type of people designing things for another type of people. A humorous example of where that idea went wrong dates from the 1950s, where a group of men asked themselves the Freudian question, what do women want? And decided that what women wanted was a car that was solid pink inside and out and contained a built-in makeup clutch. Production of this car started in 1955 and lasted for about a week and a half. So in conclusion, in this dramatically diverse world that we live in, we need to make sure that we are designing things by all types of people for all types of people. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jennifer. Well, everyone, that is our program for this week. We hope you have enjoyed it and will continue to watch us. Until next time, I'm your co-host, Keith Halperin.
I'm Will Burnick.
I'm Stacey Kennedy.
I'm Jennifer Brooks.
I'm Camilla Bixter.
I'm Mary Nisson.
I'm David Nisson.
Thank you all. And until next time, stay well and be happy.